chosen one? Why the chosen one? Why the chosen one? Why the chosen one? Never anticipated a digital shaman with a penchant for rage and destabilization of the consciousness of the many.
Genesis, we're told that the recent case of the fetus hearings actually set a precedent. Is this so?
The recent case of the fetus hearings, in fact, was predated 10 years ago when I was prosecuted for sending indecent mail under the common law and was fined the maximum on each item, which was 5 collaged postcards, and also given a suspended jail sentence of 12 months. And immediately after the court case, was warned by detectives from Scotland Yard that if I did anything subversive or out of line with their opinion of what art should be, they would immediately take me back to court and ensure that I went to prison. And then they produced a package of more postcards, which they hadn't introduced as evidence at the time.
And what was your reaction to all this sort of fuss?
Well, it was actually quite a big case at the time. I'm surprised people have forgotten. It involved the head of the British Council, Lord Goodman, quite well-known traditional artists like Bridget Riley. And at first, I admit, it seemed ridiculous and amusing. But as time went by and I was suddenly stood in the dock and realised I could be going to prison, and that my QC, who was also Geoffrey Robertson, ironically, was told that he was not allowed to speak in my defence by the clerk of the court, I got quite paranoid and certainly afterwards considered very deeply to what extent I wanted to be the token scapegoat for the art world when I was getting the minimum support from the art world. So it altered what I did. My work had to alter because it was a choice of prison or working in other countries or considering how to produce or subvert information in a different way.
Why did you do these postcards in the first place? What was the purpose?
Well, it was part of an old tradition, but the ultimate purpose was satire, really, both of the art world itself, with its there was a conceptual art movement at the time that was getting a lot of credibility, and so the idea of a picture with unrelated text appeared to be the definition of genius. I wasn't convinced about that, and thought that the man in the street was equally able to discover the same kind of imagery, and when it was presented in a certain way was when it was called art, and when it was put in the post, it was a postcard. So it was a commentary, a cynical commentary, as most of my work always has been, on hypocrisy and arrogance and pomposity, more of which I saw when I was in court.
Were you surprised at the case of the fetus hearings at all?
I wasn't surprised. I was surprised people were still taking those risks, but I was not surprised that it was taken to court, given the climate of our times, which is basically one of insidious repression and the separating of individuals, the separating of minorities, and most of all, the discrediting of freedom of thought as an option. And I think he actually was very lucky and fortunate that it wasn't more serious in terms of the sentencing. But I don't think people should be surprised, and I don't think people should expect to see overt attacks on the status quo from artists. My experience has been, since my case, that most artists are a bit like civil servants. They want to get their steady income each year, and they want to get their little job at the art college and their bursaries, and they don't want to rock the boat because they're scared of what can happen. People in this country are not given a lead by artists as radicals where once they were, and this is a nipping in the bud exercise at the very least, as well as setting a legal precedent. You know, it's like the gun to the head, it's a protection racket. If you're naughty, we'll get you. It's a reminder. It's like it's very dangerous political policy which is going on right across the board in this country, and most serious work in art is also being defined as crime of one kind or another, whether it be thought crime or literal crime, and that's why people have to work abroad so much.
You changed your style of work after your case. Do you think that other artists are now going to change their style of work after this case?
It depends on what work artists are doing at the moment. I imagine that the very interesting and provocative work is already quite secret. I think people have an inbuilt safety factor in their head which they censor themselves. That's the intention of this court case, is to try and censor people in their own minds and in their own work. I certainly have to think very hard all the time about what I can say, what I can do, what I can film, what I can make an image of or a collage of. And I know that if I step out of line, or if somebody misconstrues what I've done, or if somebody fantasizes about what they think I've done, even now, 10 years later, I immediately get vilified in the national press, and there are editorials in the Sunday People saying, cage this animal immediately and throw away the key. This was only 4 or 5 months ago. For somebody who just, from hearsay, described a video that was never made. You know, yes, it's very intimidating, and I certainly do try to work anywhere but England. You know, to me, England is an artistic dead zone, because there are thugs going around in uniform threatening anyone who tries to express something other than the common agreed status quo vision of reality. And artists, to me, are supposed to, by nature, tread the line of what is not acceptable and look inside themselves as deeply as possible to deprogram what society tells them is around. The agreed reality is not reality. There is no reality. There are no real moralities either. You know, and that is why you get endless conflict if you start to try and do something that has real content.
Let's sort of say that bit again about art. What do you think the purpose of art is?
For me, art is the ultimate questions, the ultimate thoughts, how to deprogram yourself. I believe that everyone is programmed from birth, and that that is unhealthy. And the artist is the inheritor of a tradition of wise people, shaman and priests, the ritual side of the social animal, there to expiate psychic and philosophical problems. That's what art is meant to be about, is rescuing people from the fear of death and the fear of life. And that's a very thin line. And it's also a line which our society doesn't even accept is there anymore. The reinforcement of the idea of there being a status quo and socially acceptable behavior is the norm. And I believe the artist is there to question and to destroy and cut up and reposition and collide any possibility that they see in order to try and save people from being dead while they're alive. Now that inevitably is going to cause conflict with authority.
Do you think art that shocks for shock's sake is bad art?
I don't think it's bad art. I don't think it's necessarily the technique to use at the moment to shock people for its own sake. I certainly have never tried to shock people for the sake of it, but I have taken the risk of questioning as deeply as possible any motive or any impulse that I felt I had, because I consider myself to be extraordinary, in other words, totally ordinary, like everyone else. And I believe that the drive within an artist is the same drive which can be found in every individual on the street, but normally the language it's given to them in turns them off, makes them disinterested, where in fact they should be very interested. This case is about human rights and human freedom. It just so happens to be in an art gallery, but it's the same problem that confronts a single mother trying to get a house on a housing estate from the council, or a black person trying to get a job.
Three, two, one, action.
Would you like to explain? Would you like to explain to the court, Genesis, exactly what happened after this trial?
Well, first of all, I had no money, so I had to borrow money to pay the fines, which luckily friends gave to me. I was a very poor boy at the time, and then I found that tours abroad were cancelled. I got phone calls from the Foreign Office threatening to take away my passport because I would be a bad advert for Britain. And when we had a retrospective show at the ICA 2 or 3 months later, there were queues of reporters at the door before there were queues of art fans. And also I had a criminal record, which meant that I could potentially not be allowed into certain countries ever again, could not get visas. It was a very difficult time, really. And it certainly seemed well out of proportion with something not much different to a seaside postcard.
Would you be frightened to go through all this again?
Frightened to go... Oh, would I be frightened to go through it all again? No, I wouldn't be frightened to go through it all again if it seemed the right course. I'm prepared to stand on the line and fight over the topic that I choose. But I'm a great believer in, wherever possible, choosing the battleground, choosing the weapons, and then having the duel, rather than being sneaked upon from behind and stabbed in the back.
Yeah, but if you think that the establishment considers you to be some form of animal, you do know that this charge carries a life sentence.
But being an animal carries a life sentence?
No, outraging public decency under the common law.
No, I didn't realise that. Does it really?
Yes, it does.
It can?
It can.
No, I didn't know that.
Well, how do you feel now that you do?
I think I might move out of Britain, basically. I have considered doing that.
Simply for artistic reasons or possibly for tax reasons?
That'd be the day. That'll be the day. We won't talk about tax on camera.
So,
I'm 39.
We're going to do that again. We're going to do it again. The sense of,
I didn't know. Is that right?
Yes.
Technically.
Yeah, technically. Is it? It's on the statue.
Did you get anything you wanted there, Mrs.?
Very good.
Yeah, he hasn't got one on.
Rolling.
Looks great as well.
You look tired out.
Very interesting.
More articulate. Well, when you've had people bullying you for 20 years, you kind of get used
action.
To it.
See? When you've had people bullying you for 20 years, you get what?
You get used to it, doesn't you? It becomes part of the job.
Does it become enjoyable?
It gets less enjoyable. It starts off being enjoyable when you're young to be bullied and threatened and pilloried a bit, but also you get a certain infatuation with the media and the attention. And for a while that novelty stays, and then after a while it just starts to grate. And then when you hear 10th-hand reports of what you're supposed to have done once just for the sake of shocking people when it never happened anyway, you start to get sickened by hearing these anecdotes from people that don't know you or why you do things. And after 20 years you can hardly be bothered to breathe in and out when you hear these kind of stories, because it just becomes part of this kaleidoscope of human stupidity aimed at keeping down everybody possible from real thought.
What we're going to say is that you were sick, you know, you say you're sickened after 20 years of hearing stories that this never happened in the first place. I mean, what else actually offends you about society?
Society?
Well, within
what offends?
Society.
What offends me? Well, I'm, you know, I've got two children, two girls, 1 4 and 1 6, and I'm just like any parent. I think you change a lot when you become a parent. The concept of any kind of hurt being done to children offends me, and any kind of hurt being done to women by men, or men to men by men, rape, violence. Basically, violence in all forms, and that includes aesthetics as well. And this, what we're discussing today, is violence against art, which is a very peculiar concept indeed, and one that doesn't have many precedents in previous eras. We talked earlier about the Borgias and the Renaissance, which was a very violent political time, but artists were still seen as exceptional and necessary and protected people who had a viable function within society. Where we are now, in a country with 10 years of conservative rule, is that thought itself, language itself, and expression itself of anything which is uncomfortable to the authorities is seen as a non-viable form of reality, that those people that might choose to try and express or describe what they see are in fact the equivalent of witches to be burned at the stake. And I don't think it's impossible that in 5-10 years' time we will have the continuation of a one-party state which we already have. And we will have the jackboots bashing in the door and the people shot in the streets for expressing the wrong opinion. We're having fun here, yeah?
Yeah. Hey.